all of you for being here. Thanks. As you all know, yesterday one of the very hot topics was co-creation and co-innovation. How can the different countries of Africa work together with different regions of the world? And I'm going to share with you now some examples from India and from other parts of Asia, how we can work together and what our call of action can be. So thanks to all of you. Thanks to the organizers. Thanks to the translators for keeping up with our very fast English and French in the different panels. As mentioned, I live in Bangalore in India, in South India. It's a small city, only 8 million people, but which is very small by Indian standards. We just had a very good festival last weekend called Diwali. Diwali is our New Year festival, and we give gifts and sweets to each other. So this is my Diwali gift for all of you. This is an app published from two of my books. One is called African Proverbs. As you all know, Africa has some of the most beautiful proverbs in the world. We heard one on the very first opening day. If you want to go far, walk together. If you want to go fast, walk alone. So if you are in the long run, you have to work together. That's one of the proverbs. And the other one is a collection of quotes and proverbs to inspire founders and entrepreneurs. So these are free apps on Android. I think it's €1 or something on iTunes. So you're most welcome to download and share this for everyone and inspire yourselves. So I'm here today because many of you are successful entrepreneurs already. And our challenge as people who have been there, done that, is to inspire the next generation of entrepreneurs. So for example, the typical knowledge cycle of an entrepreneur is how to come up with ideas. So can we accelerate the flow of ideas among youth in Africa, for example? Can you then take these ideas and then make them products and companies? That is the second step. And the third step is, can you come up with sharing of best practices, knowledge management, etc.? How do big companies work with startups? How do hospitals, like the one we heard in the previous panel, how do they use technology, and so on? And after this, you have to reinvent yourself. The challenge of an entrepreneur is not just to come up with that first big idea, but also the next big idea, and so on. So this is where I think we can collaborate on sharing ideas, sharing products, platforms, and best practices for innovation. I live in India, but I have the very good fortune to do a lot of work in Africa. I've traveled to more than 15 African countries. I do work in conferences. We publish books and research reports. And I want to invite any of you who have an idea on, should we do a report on mobile startups in Africa? We did a report a few years ago called the Mobile Africa Report, and so on. I'm also a huge fan of African music. Any of you who've been in the field of music would know that when it comes to music, Africa is a superpower. It has an amazing range of genres, some amazing artists who are popular all over the world. There's also an amazing design ethic emerging now in Africa. I was in Addis recently for the Africa Design Week competition, and that amazing artists, galleries, and so on from all over Africa showing their work. And I think digital is a great way to scale up this kind of collaboration for art, technology, startups, and so on. So I'm going to begin with a framework called the Global Entrepreneurship Monitor Framework, GEM. You can see that on top of the list. I will share this presentation with you through the organizers. I may also put it on SlideShare, so don't worry about taking notes. So this is the framework for how does the startup ecosystem of a country or a continent look like? And we heard some of this yesterday in the startup business model, the startup ecosystem canvas, how to map the ecosystem of innovation in a country. So my suggestion towards the end of this presentation will be on how can we work together to accelerate the innovation ecosystems in Africa, in different parts of the world, by focusing on not just technology and business models, but also the internal journey of an entrepreneur. My work in Your Story is on focusing on what are the challenges that an entrepreneur faces when they go through the journey of innovation. How do they get an idea? How do they convince people that the idea works? How do they go through the conflict in their own social circles? We all come from societies where there's a lot of hierarchy. There's tribalism, there's classism, there's feudalism, there's all kinds of distinctions and classes in many traditional societies. How does an entrepreneur break free and create a digital platform, for example, in health, education, and so on? So here's what we do. Here's how storytelling has helped. We work with three kinds of audiences. One is those who want to launch a startup, those who want to become an entrepreneur. How do you get an idea? How do you go to business, and so on? The second part is those who want to join a startup. Maybe you don't want to be a founder yourself, but you can become the chief product officer, chief designer, a coder, a developer, a tester. There's also huge roles for these in a startup. And third is we also work with big multinational companies on helping them engage with startups. Startups are getting ideas much faster today than the big companies. So how do you as a big company set up an accelerator or an incubator? How do you engage with the startup ecosystem? That's what we do. We cover a lot of founder stories, stories of founders and so on. We also believe that to scale up the entrepreneurship revolution, you need to do two things. Scale up the intellect of the startup ecosystem. So for example, we have reviewed over 100 books on entrepreneurship, innovation, and creativity. As you all know, founders and entrepreneurs are too busy to read books and books every week. So we help them out by summarizing all the very important insights on creativity, business tools, and so on. And these are shared. Any of you are most welcome to read and share these with your own startup networks. And we also are doing a lot of work on inspiration, how to inspire young people to become entrepreneurs. And we find that in addition to text and books and all that, photographs, videos, audio, etc., are very interesting ways to inspire startups. So if you see a picture of someone who looks like you, who has done some very interesting startup work in some other country, maybe you think, I can also do this same thing myself. So let me give you some examples. This is the first tool we have developed, and this is an open tool. Anyone can download this and share it. You've heard yesterday of the business model canvas, the startup ecosystem canvas. This is the storytelling canvas. How should an entrepreneur tell the story of their life? So if you remember what we heard on the first day from the co-founder of Usha Hidi, she talked about how she grew up in the fringe. She was on the outskirts of literally the city. One day she worked at AT&T in the US, and she said, wow, I can see all these new technologies emerging. Then she had an ouch moment when she said, look at all the riots happening in the post-election period. I want to solve this problem. Then she got into solving the problem of mapping different kinds of activities during a crisis or an earthquake. She ended up by saying, in year so-and-so, the world will be like this. So she told us that in the year 2050, more than half of the world's population growth will come from Africa. And therefore, in that world, she wants to give students access to technology. So she created BRIC and so on. So this is the structure of a story of an entrepreneur. And we published this as an open canvas. So you can print this out on an A4 sheet. You can put this on your phone. You can print this on an A0 sheet so everybody can see what you're plotting. And this is the structure of a story for entrepreneurs. So this is the story change canvas, which we share with other people. I also mentioned photographs. We had very recently in Bangalore a maker fair. A maker fair is somewhat like that Fab Lab Casablanca that you see outside. This is a lot of hardware objects that people build. And we take photos of this and share this with students in other parts of the world. For example, on the left, top left, there's a guy who has made a unicycle, which is very stable. So if you're about to fall off balance, it'll make a buzzing sound and correct itself. On the top right is a guy who has made a home brewing machine. You can brew beer at home. Okay, so you've heard of microbreweries. This is a nano brewery. So you can experiment with different flavors and create new kinds of beer if you want. For example, in Morocco, mint tea is very popular. How about mint beer? I have no idea, but maybe somebody can make it, test it, and show it to other people. So this is meant to tap the beverage industry and allow people to become entrepreneurs in the beverage industry. On the bottom left is a company which does upcycling. You've heard of recycling, recycled old products. They take used, old discarded tires from trucks and motorcycles, and they make furniture out of this. And this is sold to very trendy cafes, to colleges, to schools, to poorer communities, and so on. So this is upcycling. And on the bottom right is something very interesting. It's called a maker auto. That's a three-wheeler tuk-tuk auto rickshaw kind of a thing. And you put maker tools inside it. So this can take a 3D printer, a laser cutter, wood cutters, etc. And you can take this to the smaller towns, smaller cities, and even villages. And you can let students play around with all these objects and create their own activities. So we think these are some very powerful ways of scaling up and inspiring people about the revolution in manufacturing. I mentioned earlier artwork. I was in Addis and I met a very interesting woman called Selamit Alane. She runs an art gallery in Ethiopia, one of the largest art galleries in Addis. And she wants to take artwork, like the one you see on the top right, and she wants to promote this all over the world. She thinks Ethiopia is a very good hub of design, and so she's using e-commerce. She's got a global distribution center now in Washington, D.C., and using a website, you can order different kinds of artwork, and they can send you originals, they can send you copies, they can send you prints. So that's a great way of using digital to scale up the entrepreneurship in the art community. There's a very good book which talks about some of this. I hope you've seen it, Success in Africa. Jonathan Berman has got very good insights and advice for big companies who want to engage with African startups and so on. And on the bottom right is one of my favorite photographs. It's one of the best things I've ever seen in my life. This is a rainbow in the Victoria Falls in Zimbabwe. And when I first saw this, I thought, is this a Photoshop thing or something? Because in all my life, I've seen a rainbow up in the sky. But here I'm looking inside the valley, and there's a rainbow inside the valley. This is exactly what it looks like in Zimbabwe. And ladies and gentlemen, that's my message to you. The rainbow today is in Africa. The pot of gold that everyone looks for, one end of that rainbow is in Africa, and the other one is in different parts of the world. So your challenge now is to find out how to tap these kinds of digital innovations and find partners to market this and sell it in different parts of the world. So the framework I have to share with all of you in terms of how can we cooperate between the different countries of Africa and outside is based on a framework we've used in our book series called the 8 C's of the digital economy. They all begin with the letter C, obviously. So first is connectivity. Can we share affordable devices? Can we share affordable network models with each other? So brick is a good example we heard from on the first day. Different kinds of designs for mesh networks. That's a good example of sharing ideas. Second is content. We heard a lot on day one from the panel which I moderated on how we can share content across different parts of the world, translate it, localize it in different languages. Then third is community, how to build the community of innovation across different countries. So IT clubs is one example. I showed you the example of the mobile makerspace, the mobile auto, which has tools for making mobile labs. Fourth is capacity, how to scale up education about entrepreneurship. Can we share examples of best practices? Can we share examples of ideation activities between big companies, small companies, and so on? We also heard some discussion on the first day on that education panel, which I moderated, on accelerating the ERNet, education and research networks, in the big African and the smaller African countries, which is networks connecting universities, colleges, and schools to share education, textbooks, and so on. Then there is commerce. We already heard about this yesterday, how to promote different kinds of platforms for buying and selling. This depends on the business model and the mobile operator support in each country. Number six, very important for our kind of work, is the culture. How to scale up the culture of entrepreneurship by sharing stories of entrepreneurs. Yesterday, we had a very good example of from the founder of True Africa. That's a site which shares stories of African innovation and entrepreneurs. That's exactly what we're talking about here, how to share the mindset of entrepreneurship with different kinds of organizations. A big challenge also is cooperation. I'm suggesting to Africa for Tech that we form perhaps the Association of African Accelerators, the network of African incubators, to share lessons between the different accelerators and incubators. These are both corporate accelerators as well as government and academic incubators. And last but not least, how to come up with business models. We had some good examples in the previous panel on how to build sustainable financing for medical health, for digital health, and so on. So I think these are 8 areas where we can take a look at how to cooperate between the different countries of Africa and outside the region. So many of you are successful entrepreneurs, and my call to action for all of you is to look at the last item over here, which is many of you have done the starting up stage, you have done the scaling up stage, and maybe even selling off your startup to some other company. The last one is what we all have to do, which is how to now strengthen the startup ecosystem in our countries, how to build associations, and how to accelerate this whole culture of thought leadership. So how do we do this? The first step would be perhaps to look at what are the kinds of innovation which might scale very well, which may not scale very well, and so on. So if you look at the business literature on innovation, you will notice that there are 10 very common types of innovation. They can be a product innovation, it can be a service innovation, or a business model innovation. So I would suggest that maybe business model innovation is where a lot of the action now is. A lot of us have agreed on things like the usefulness of the Android platform and different kinds of tools for launching apps by category, education, health, energy, and so on. So maybe now the challenge is, how do we share knowledge on how to scale up a business model in different countries? So for example, M-Pesa has worked very well in a few African countries, but not so much in other countries because the ecosystem is different. So what are the challenges in mapping out a business model canvas and comparing it and scaling it up to other parts of the world? That could be one area that we work. The second area is in ideation. We've analyzed in our database about 10,000 stories of founders, and we tried to look at how does a successful founder get an idea for the product. So we found there are 10 categories of ideas. One is, for example, I'm passionate about something, can I build a product out of it? My degree is in something else, can I build a product out of it? We find that the next two are the most interesting ones. The most successful entrepreneurs are those who have faced a problem themselves. They solve the problem, and in that process, they help other people also solve a similar problem. A very closely related one is number four, which is somebody in my family has a problem. It could be education, health, finance, something like that. And by solving their problem, I also solve the problem for others who have a similar problem. So this is where empathy is a very important factor. Some of the most successful entrepreneurs are those who have empathy with the people who they're trying to help. They actually have felt the problems which their customers are facing and so on. And the list goes down. I can share this presentation and you can see it afterwards. So some examples. Here's what we did last month in Bangalore. We had we partnered with an event called the Startup EU India Summit, and we invited 20 startups from Europe and India, 10 investors from Europe and India, and 5 government policymakers from Europe and India to discuss what are some common problems that startups face. Can we connect and accelerate different kinds of startups by twinning? And can we connect also the investors to look at, can you find scalable business models from Asia to other parts of Europe? And we can use a similar model here in Europe as well. So to sum up the first part of my presentation, this is my call to action, which is there are at least 4 areas where I would like to invite all of you to work with us, Africa for Tech and Your Story, in these 4 areas. Number one, research. Publishing good, high quality primary research on entrepreneurship in Africa. So do we have, for example, data on the different startup ecosystems in Africa? We had a very good talk yesterday on the startup ecosystem canvas. So can we use a crowdsourcing platform like Ushahidi and build a whole startup canvas for Africa? The second one would be to conduct different kinds of surveys and reports on what's happening with innovation and digital startups in the region. Second, as I mentioned earlier, to build associations, the Africa Association of Accelerators, for example, and of incubators, of educators, and so on. Third is maybe a mentorship network. As mentioned yesterday, mentorship is a very big challenge for scaling up the entrepreneurship network. Yesterday, Navi Rajo mentioned the example of the Indus Entrepreneurs. It's a global network of successful entrepreneurs and consultants who help startups in different parts of the world boot up, ramp up, and connect with each other. And last but not least, to improve the storytelling techniques. Africa is a great country for storytellers. Can we combine that with entrepreneurship and build up very good stories of successful African entrepreneurs as well? So for example, in Asia now, we're rolling out something called the Student Perception Survey. What do students in schools and college think about technology, about business, about entrepreneurship? Who are their role models? What kind of a dream job do they want? If they want to become a startup or an entrepreneur or an innovator, what challenges do they face? How do they become more creative? How do they become more innovative? So these are different kinds of surveys that we're rolling out in different parts of Asia, and you're most welcome to grab this survey and roll it out in your own countries. You can add some questions, share it back with us, etc. For example, there are 3 or 4 examples I'll wrap up with now. This is the E27 startup network in Singapore. They're headquartered in Singapore, but they have built a database of startups across Southeast Asia. So if you want to find out who are the startups in e-commerce, for example, in different parts of Southeast Asia, you can search and find out. There's this guy in Indonesia, there's another one in Vietnam, and there's one in the Philippines. So this is a database-centric approach to mapping the startup ecosystem in a region. This is the second example. I go to Barcelona every February for the Mobile World Congress, and they've come up with a very interesting map, the Barcelona Research and Innovation Map, which takes the database-centric approach of the previous example and maps it onto a crowdsourced map. So you can actually go to this particular map by sector and look at, for example, I want to see a research and technology park. I want to find out creative environments for musicians and artists. And it'll tell you, you can click on each of those color-coded arrows, and it'll tell you what is available in Barcelona in which area of innovation and entrepreneurship. So can we come up with a similar map like this for Africa is my open invitation to all of you to create. So maybe we can rope in some help from Ushahidi and help come up with a crowdsourced map of innovation, etc. in Africa. To succeed in the long run, I would suggest these are some issues, some guidelines that we must keep in mind. First of all is the balance between wanting to do something and setting specific annual targets. Like by this year, we should map out all the incubators in Africa. In another quarter, we should map up all the accelerators in Africa. So build project-based guidelines for an open goal. Build with what you have. Frugal innovation. No need to get some big fancy funding from big international agencies to get this done. Build with who we have, which is all the people you here in the room, all of you. Secondly, to mix offline and online, social media is great to build a crowdsource map, but you also need maybe events like this to build synergy and ideas on different kinds of things. Fourth is to make it attractive for all ages. These days, the age of innovators is coming lower and lower. People are starting up in college. People are starting up in school even. So can you promote this culture of ideation and entrepreneurship right down to the ages of school and college children? Connect to larger organizations for scale. I'm very happy that many big companies are here in our conference here this week because they are the key to scaling up many of the solutions that entrepreneurs are providing, especially in the area of B2B kind of solutions. Align with multiple partners. This is a big challenge in many countries. The government and the entrepreneurs do not see eye to eye. If you were here on the panel that I moderated yesterday, we had a very interesting discussion on, is government a good partner for an entrepreneur? And half the panel said, beyond a certain stage, you cannot scale without government help. And the other half of the panel said, screw the government. Don't work with the government at all. Ignore them and do what you have to do. So here's where there's a bit of challenge. How do you facilitate good discussion and synergy between the different stakeholders? Marry business with social good. I'm very happy that there are many social entrepreneurs who've been here at this panel. Yesterday, I was sitting next to a woman who had made the affordable portable refrigerator. So this is two clay pots with some sand and water in between. It's a very affordable cooler. So that's the kind of thing that we need, social enterprise also. Innovative ideas are everywhere. So there's amazing creativity coming out of emerging economies. And our challenge is to keep finding these ideas. So holding ideation contests, et cetera, was a good example. We saw in the startup ecosystem canvas yesterday that for very early stage entrepreneurs, it's important to have ideation events. So how to have student business model competitions, business plan ideas, et cetera, is a very important thing to have. We should also make this a fun activity. Many academics who teach innovation tend to be a bit on the dry side, which is okay. But our challenge as people who love entrepreneurship is to make it fun also. It's not just hard work, but it's also fun. And last but not least, it will be a bit messy. Any kind of cooperation like this will be a bit messy, but we just have to learn to live with it. I'll end with this. If you look at what we all hear about, innovation, the word innovation has two parts, in and ovation. And I want to give you all an ovation for doing what you do in the area of innovation. Thank you, and we have about 10 minutes for Q&A, so I'll be very happy to take questions from the audience. Questions, comments? Thank you. Oh, the ovation is for you, huh? Not for me. Yeah. Questions, comments? How many of you are startups in the audience? Startups, entrepreneurs? Please raise your hands. Oh, very good. So we've been there, done that. We need to talk to you guys now. So the rest of you are, how many of you are from government? Government agencies, ministries? Okay, good. How many of you are from big multinational companies, MNCs, tech parks? Okay, good. Any, who else is here now? Media, paparazzi? Oh, good. Friends of the media. Yeah, yes. Yes, question. First question gets an iPad from the organizers.
Thank you for your presentation. You talked about the average age of an entrepreneur falling and many of them now coming out of high schools. Can you speak a little bit about some of the success stories of the high school entrepreneur who's been successful?
Yeah. We have quite a few entrepreneurs at the high school stage who've worked on, for example, food tech, food solutions. Many of them have their own ideas on what kind of food works for younger people, what kind of mixes of snacks, drinks, etc. So we're seeing food tech as one. Second category is campus solutions. Campus solutions for housing, for safety at night, etc. A lot of solutions on exchanging textbooks. So whenever students graduate, they throw away their books or something like that. So can you build a matchmaking platform for those who have books and those who want to buy books? So a lot of these are there. We've also seen some of them doing sharing of clothing, which is now also happening in the high-end fashion sector. So there's a party or a religious function you're going for, and you've got some very nice clothes which you wear only once or twice a year. So can you share that with other people? So in sharing economy, there's a lot of very interesting stuff coming out from the high school students because their ideas on sharing are very different from the older generation of ownership. What I buy is what I own, it's mine. But the younger generation says, what I buy is mine, but I don't mind sharing it with other people. So some of this sharing kind of platform startups are becoming very popular. Yeah. Yes, question in the front.
Hi, Madan. Thanks for a great talk. My question was more in terms of, are you aware of any best practices where larger organizations are teaming up or partnering with startups, as you had mentioned, because startups are a lot quicker in terms of their getting products on the market? And how can larger organizations tap into that?
Oh, great, great question. As I mentioned earlier, a lot of our audience in at Your Story is also big companies who want to find out what are some engagement platforms, activities, and so on for startups. So three, four examples are a very easy way to just test the market for startup ideas is to hold an idea competition or an idea prize or a challenge to set a target like how to reduce traffic in our city. Have a competition and have people design apps on ride sharing, etc. That's one easy way. A more systematic way would be to organize a hackathon. So you may have some tools of your own that you want to share with the outside community, and you tell them, I want to offer 10 licenses of this product or 10 examples of this car or something for the audience. And I want you all to come and spend a weekend hacking some kind of a solution based on this. So you make a big competition, you gamify the whole thing, etc., and you do that. The third most systematic one is you have an accelerator. So you define a goal as, for example, we've done work with Target, which is a retailer. We've done work with IBM, which is a big software services company, in terms of how to get ideas from startups to build the next generation of enterprise software products. One example we have in Target is there was a startup who built a heat sensing app, which means in different aisles of the supermarket, it had little beacons, and it could track how many smartphone users are in each aisle at each time. So in real time, the supermarket manager in any city in the world for that chain could see which aisle has the most traffic. Maybe that is because it's a popular product. Maybe it's a confusing arrangement of products on the shelves. So they will send somebody to that particular aisle and find out why are people over here. So this was a startup which used beacon technology to do mapping of traffic in the aisles. So that's one example of how accelerators can engage with startups. And last but not least is things like co-working spaces and entrepreneur in residence. So some big companies have set up a co-working space where their innovators go and sit with startups just to get a sense of the culture, what are they talking about, what is the gossip, what are the hot things they're doing. In return, you give them free rent and coffee and you know, beer and kebabs, whatever they want. And the other one is entrepreneur in residence. You invite, you give a prize to what you think is the most outstanding entrepreneur in your category, and you tell them, we invite you to come and work out of our office, maybe one day a week, and in exchange, you get to talk to all our chief product engineers, and maybe you can share some ideas, and if we like your idea, you can sell it to us first before any other product. So I put a whole list of 15 such engagements. I'd be very happy to email you a link to that article. Yeah. Any other questions? We have 3 minutes left. Well, I have a question. I can also have the right to ask questions also. So I want to invite our friends from Fab Lab Casablanca to come up on stage. I want to ask you guys a few questions now. How are you getting students into the Fab Lab?
I speak from my experience. I'm a student too. At first, I had an idea to make a lock that's open and that you can open it with the Bluetooth or an NFC. So when I started, I'm a developer side. I don't know much about electronics, so I needed someone to help me with the electronics. In my city, there's much. I didn't find the community, makers community. So I traveled to Casablanca, which is a bigger city. I found the Fab Lab there, where I met other people who were passionate also about making stuff, and I met other startups and other people. I helped them with what I know, and they helped me in the electronics part. And I made my project, and I participated in a competition, and I got the first prize that year. So that's how I met the Fab Lab the first time. After that, I came in just to help others and learn about more about electronics.
This, by the way, is a very good way for big companies to engage with innovators and startups, which is to fund a Fab Lab or a maker space. The Maker Faire example I showed you early on, the Mini Maker Faire, had corporate support from Adobe, from Synergistics, from Bosch, from Schlumberger, from Siemens, etc., who want to engage with young people to find out how are they viewing objects in very different ways. Now, he's very lucky because he got all this access as a student, but there are many people who don't have the luxury of having these kinds of things as students. So the younger you catch them, like this young, dynamic entrepreneur, the better you can get success for your own initiatives. Thanks. Any recommendations you have on how to get better? What's your dream wish list for your Fab Lab? You want more people, facilities, machines?
I want, the problem is that in schools we focus on more reading and writing. There's much working with your hand. engaging with the society, making your ideas come to life. We just study stuff, remember them, go to the exam, write the answers. Kids have ideas, small ideas, but if you nurture them, they can become big. So we'd like to invite students to places where they can see other people working on crazy ideas sometimes, but those ideas, when they come to life, they become a success. So to motivate kids, because the kids are the future. So when I go to, sometimes I in my spare time, I go to schools, and I try to talk with kids to see what ideas they have and show them that everything is possible. Kids now, they start thinking that they want to be an astronaut. When they go bigger, oh, I'm a teacher. Or they lose that passion for passion for life. So if we engage kids at a younger age in the making community, we can come up with big solutions in the future.
Great. I think that's a point which Nomvu also made yesterday, which is thank you. A round of applause for a young friend from FabLab Casablanca.
When talking about in Cameroon, we are always facing a problem, the problem of money. I don't really know if it is the same problem with other countries, but most of the young people are thinking in Cameroon that we need money before having a startup or before making an idea becoming a startup. So I think we should communicate in a on that point, to say that first the idea, and at the second plane the money, because the money will come when we get the idea, the right idea. Now, concerning what the woman said, since yesterday I'm hearing people talking about having a system out of academic system, try to change the way people or young people are studying at school. But why not just improve or help the system academic to be changed instead of creating another system out of the system, out of the academic system? I think we are already in the academic system. If we want to create another system, this will ask a lot of work, instead of just trying to change the system in which young people are already. So that is what I wanted to say. We should just try to change it, to improve the way young people are studying, to make them change their mind. Thank you.
Great. I know that we had someone from ISEC in the audience. Maybe that was there yesterday. Are you from ISEC? Yeah. Do you want to say a little bit about how ISEC is promoting more of entrepreneurial thinking? I've met many ISEC young digital champions in conferences in, you know, South Africa, AIESEC, is that you? No. No, but go ahead, you want to add some other comments? Sorry, that's okay, go on.
So I work at ISEC Business School. So we have three campuses, one in Paris, one in Rabat, and one in Singapore. What we do in entrepreneurship is we have incubators. We also have, I think, programs that are interesting is that we mix the engineer students with the design students and business students. Well, one program is called CPI. Like one initiative that emerged from this program is Gentoli. Maybe you know it. One mobile health program in Mali and Burkina Faso. So yeah, good program. We have also concours, I'd say, competitions. Metrax, for example, for one of our competition, we organize JSVC for French-speaking countries. You stop me if I speak too long. So we have contests, incubators. We mixed publics. That's the way we try to build an ecosystem around education and our students.
Great. So I think one common element from what both three of you actually said is you have to mix up and mash up people from different disciplines. One challenge with many of our education systems is it's all rigid and siloed. You're an engineer or a designer or a media person or something else. So what Fab Labs, et cetera, do is they mix people from very different disciplines, different ages, et cetera, so that creativity can flow. So a lot of time, you don't even see what's possible unless you meet someone from another discipline of your age, someone like you perhaps, and then that's how creativity flows. So maybe that's a good message to end this session with, which is mix up, mash up, and let creativity flow and scale up the flow of ideas and funding. Thank you all very much, and back to Stefan.